to something else, so you have to do a more precise analysis. Now here one more little notation that the notation rho is used a little bit for two different things, which are actually the same thing, but a little bit abuse of notation. So rho here means that in the picture, when I draw the picture, then this is just a probability measure on the real line, so it's a probability measure. But then here I use the rho with the argument z, so I put complex argument into the rho, and by that I mean just the analytic container, the harmonic extension of this measure to the upper half plane, which is also the same thing as the imaginary part of m of z. So just put it here, so rho z, it's everything is very consistent, it just, maybe sometimes you get confused that rho sometimes is a real object, and sometimes rho has an argument in the upper half, and sometimes it's only in the real line, but in the upper half is just a harmonic extension. Okay, so that's what, so this is the statement, and let me just show how one proves it. The proofs are very, very simple. It's more like setting up the right conditions and so on, which is the critical one. So we just write up the key equation. The key equation is just look at the original equation here, or it's here, and then you take its imaginary part. It turns out that the imaginary part of this equation carries a useful information. If you take the imaginary part of -1/m, m is a complex number, then you get imaginary part of m divided by m absolute value square. Remember all these conventions. This is a vector, with each element is the imaginary part of mi divided by mi absolute value square. But I'm not going to write indices. And this is what you get when you take the imaginary part of that side. Here the imaginary part of z is just eta. But of course this eta also is understood as a vector of eta, eta, eta. And then you have the s. S is positive, so the imaginary part goes through it, and then the S will act on the imaginary part of M. Okay, so that's this basic equation here, and then you start using this bound that the SV is comparable with its average, and then you start estimating from below and from above. So let me just go through it quickly. These are all elementary informations once you know. That you have to look at the imaginary part of the original equation. So for example, you can start with taking a lower bound of this S imaginary part of M using this property. Imaginary part of M is always positive, it's a positive vector. So you can start bounding it from below by the imaginary part of M. And here I'm neglecting constants, and all the constants are, if you wish, included in this Wigner notation. So you have that. And now you multiply through with the m square. So from this one you get imaginary part of m is bigger than m square times imaginary part average. Again, everything is done component-wise, which is not indicated in notation. And then now you take the average of that equation. So if you take the average of this equation, then you get that the imaginary part. On this side, you get the average of imaginary part. On that side, there's already an imaginary part average, which is a constant, a scalar, so that it's not affected. But then you take the average of the m absolute value square, and the average of m absolute value square is exactly the L2 norm square. So you get that. Okay, now you simplify with the imaginary part of M, and then you get an upper bound on the L2 norm of the solution. So this is the first thing here. This is how you get how you improve the original 1/8 bound to something which is an order 1 bound. But for the moment, it's not in the L infinity norm, which is a stronger norm. It's only in the L2 norm. Okay, so that's the first thing which you get. Now, how to get the other bound, which is now an L infinity bound, but it may deteriorate with the rho. This you also get in the same way. You get basically from that equation, but you read it from the other direction. So let me just write up. So So you operate with the same equation, smaller than imaginary part of M. I just read the same equation in the other direction. But the imaginary part of M is, of course, always smaller than M, absolute value. The imaginary part of everything is any complex number is smaller than M. And now you can simplify with it, with one of the M, and then you get that, and then divide through, and then you just get the imaginary part of M, that M is bounded by imaginary part of M. Okay, so that's this other bound. So this is a bound which I have advertised here, that you can have a bound in terms of one over rho. But you can also have, alternatively, you can have another bound, that M is always bounded by the 1 over distance to the support, because M is a Stieltjes transform, and that's a basic property of the Stieltjes transform, that away from the support of the measure, it basically follows directly from the integral representation, away from the support of the measure, the size of the Stieltjes transform, which has the 1 over distance of that. Okay, so this is the alternative bound. And finally, you can also get a bound in, you can get a bound on 1 over mi. So far we had an upper bound, now if you wish you have a lower bound on mi, which you formulate as an upper bound on 1 over mi just by using the equation, taking absolute value in this equation. For simplicity, let me just do it when z is on a finite set. And then you estimate have to estimate the L infinity norm of s times m, but then you use the upper bound on s, use a bound of that type, and then you see that you pick up the L1 norm. This is what you get out of it as an L1 norm first, but then by the Hölder inequality, you can estimate it by the L2 norm, and the L2 norm was already bounded. Okay, and then once you have an upper bound on 1 over mi, then again you go back to this basic equation here, and then you see you have a bound on 1 over m or 1 over m square, you have an upper bound on that, so you can read this inequality from this side, and the average imaginary part of m will be bounded from above by the imaginary part of m, divided by times 1 over m, but 1 over m is now already bounded, so you can forget about it here. Okay, so this will give a lower bound on the components of imaginary part of M in terms of the average, and the upper bound is similarly easy. Then you read this equation from the other direction. You want to estimate this from above, so you estimate this side from above. S times imaginary part of M is basically the average, and then you get the upper bound. Okay, so you don't have to follow it in every details. Just shows that these are sort of relatively simple operations, and everything goes back to the imaginary part of the original equation. Okay, so now let me introduce something more interesting, which is actually a fundamental object in all our analysis. We call it the self-energy operator F. So the operator matrix. I mean, the situation it will be a matrix. So in order to see that, let me rewrite this equation here in a little bit different form. I'm doing this equation. Just rewrite it, but the useful rewriting. It's imaginary part of M divided by M, so one of the, out of this M absolute value square I pull one of them on the other side. It's equal to eta times M, this is not important, and then plus M, so it's multiplied from this direction. And then I want to smuggle into the argument of S, or S is a vector, so S acts on that vector. I want to smuggle in the imaginary part M over M, so I want to write it in such a way that it's S acting on M times imaginary part M over M. So I just smuggled in this M. But now I would like to view this as an equation on this quantity, on the imaginary part of M divided by M absolute value. I mean, on that side, you see that quantity directly. So this is this guy. This one doesn't matter. Remember that I'm interested in the tiny eta regime. So if you wish, I will be able to forget about it. That's not the important thing. But then here I see that there's a new operator, a linear operator acting on the imaginary part of M. Divided by M, so this will be the F matrix acting on this guy. And if you wish, then this is the definition of the F. So here it's written out more explicitly. So F is a linear map which acts on any vector in such a way that you first multiply this vector by the vector M, entry-wise multiply, then you let the S act on it, and then you multiply the result by M. So this is a other more formal definition of the operator F, the matrix F, and if you want it, it is written out in coordinates. Actually, it's 1/n and it's probably wrong. It was some leftover. Okay, so that's what we have. Now, the point is that we would like to play with this F operator, this F matrix, and this F matrix has a few very nice properties. So first of all, it's a symmetric matrix. It's easy to see that if you take the usual scalar product, then the form looks like symmetric. S is symmetric, and it's sandwiched between M and M on the same side, on the two sides. So it's F is symmetric. And also it has positive matrix or non-negative matrix elements, because S has this property, and M absolute value also has this property. So then you can use the Perron-Frobenius theorem, which says the following, that in such a situation, you have an eigenvector, a non-negative eigenvector called F, which is actually the maximal, which picks up the maximal eigenvalue in terms of absolute value. So this the corresponding eigenvalue of this eigenvector is just the norm of F. Okay, and then under some conditions, some irreducibility condition, which actually follows from this lower bound in our case, you will know that this eigenvector is unique. So let me just take this situation when this one is actually Fij is strictly positive. This is a simpler situation, and then there is a unique eigenvector. In that case, the eigenvector has positive elements, such that F is the norm times F. Okay, so that's what Perron-Frobenius says. Now, why is this good? Well, go back to our basic equation, this equation here, and scalar multiply this equation by F. So let me do this calculation. So you get F times this imaginary part M divided by M equals eta Fm, this guy here. Here everything is positive, I don't have to worry about complex conjugates. And now I scalar multiply this equation by F. So I have F imaginary part M. Okay, but now F is positive, F is symmetric, I can pull it on the other side, and then F hits its own eigenvector. So this guy here is just the F, and eigenvector is of course just the norm of F. So this turns out to be just that and F imaginary part M over M. So that's a simple formula. But now you see that the same quantity appears on the two sides. So from this one you can express, so this is this last formula here. Let me go next step. So from this one, from this identity, from this formula, you can just express the F and the norm of F. So what you conclude, all these things are positive numbers. This is positive, this is positive, this is positive. So all the divisions are fine. And then you express the F, and then you get this is 1 minus and something. Let me not write up precisely, it's on the transparency. So most importantly, this is smaller than 1. So you get a bound in this using this Perron-Frobenius thing. You get a bound on this F operator. And this bound is 1. The constants here, the S operator, had some constants here, but this constant didn't play any role here. It just disappeared. The only slight thing that I use, but it's easy to remove, I use the irreducibility, so I just use that Sij is not 0, even that is easy to remove. The bound here is uniform. It's a universal bound. It's independent of any input. And this is what it makes a very useful bound. You see that the F operator is a funny thing. The F operator consists of two parts. There is the S matrix, which is our original input, and there is the M, which is a complicated object. It's for that you have to solve the equation. And S could be very large, could be very small. Similarly, the M, the solution, could be very large, very small. Everything can happen. But this particular combination of the M and the S, if you write it in this form, and this particular combination is bounded. It's always bounded by one. Okay, so that's a useful bound. Okay. And now once you have that, once you have this norm, then you can easily prove an unconditional bound on the L2 norm in that case. Now for that you go back to the equation here and express simply the M from that equation, which is not very hard. I'll just write up here. So from the QVE, you can express the M, just rearrange that equation for M. And then you get probably there's a minus 1 over z times 1 plus m times sm. Okay, this is just take this equation, multiply it through by m, and here you get a z times m, and then from the z times m you divide through by z and express the m in terms of 1 over z plus everything else. Now again, I mean here you have to write everything in short, but you have to read it properly. So this means the following, these are m and m, these are vectors. So this vector m is acted upon by the matrix S, you get a new vector, and then you multiply entry-wise that vector by the m again. So what you see here is a vector. Okay? And now you want to estimate it's in L2 norm, so the L2 norm, or maybe L2 norm squared, no, it's just the L2 norm. The L2 norm is bounded by 1 over z. The 1 has an L2 norm 1, because remember that my norm is, L2 norms are normalized. That's why it was good to divide the 1 over n in the L2 norms. And then here I have the MSM, the L2 norm of that by triangle inequality. But this MSM can be estimated in such a way that that I smuggle in the absolute value. So 1 plus absolute value MS. M, I need one more line, and then what is this MS, what is this MSM, this is a vector again, so it's a vector, but it's very reminiscent to the F operator, so the MSM vector you can get from the F operator in such a way if you plug in the 1, the 1, 1, 1, 1, 1 vector into the F, if I plug here 1, then I get exactly the MSM vector, so just finish here, so this guy here is just the F acted upon, F acted on the vector 1. And this is an L2 norm, I forget here the 2, so this is L2 norm, and now this is smaller than 1, because F was bounded in L2 norm, this norm here is the usual L2 operator or matrix norm, and the 1 had L2 norm 1, so this is just bounded by 1, and in that way you get the uniform bound of 2 over z for the L2 norm. And again, the point here is that this bound did not use anything. It did not use any quantitative properties of the S operator, lower and upper bound, it's just 2 every all the time. And of course it's true, it's a good bound as long as you are away from zero. Exactly at zero this bound is not very useful, but there's a good reason for that depending, if you don't assume anything about this S, as I did here, then you cannot hope that the solution will be bounded, solution will remain bounded at zero. For example, if S is just not there, if S is zero at all, then the solution is of course M is 1 over Z, that blows up. So there's some truth in this blow up here. Okay, so this is the second thing, and let me just do quickly the third type of bound. So remember I said there will be three bounds. One of them was an L2 bound, which is useful in the bulk, which was estimated in terms of the 1 over rho. Then there was this unconditional L2 bound, which didn't require anything about the S, but this blows up at zero. These are all L2 bounds, but at the end of the day, I need an L-infinity bound. I want to improve this bound in L infinity, but on that side I would like to see something which is order 1. And in order to do that, you need some extra condition, and this is again, the condition is not optimal, but some kind of condition of that type is needed. So let me just do it in the simplest, present it in simplest form. I assume that the S is a piecewise Herder 1/2 continuous function. So the simplest way to express this is that if you assume you don't need it, but that's the easiest way to present it, if you assume that the Sij comes from a profile, so Sij is a matrix, a big N by M matrix, but you can imagine that this that there is a function S, which is a continuous, which is not a continuous, but which is a function on the continuum on the 0, 1, 0, 1 square, and then the Sij is just this value of the function on the grid points of the 1 over N grid within the square. Okay, so you can imagine that way. And then in, if you form it, in, if you require that, then you know very precisely what Herder continuity means. And Herder continuity means that this function S should be 1/2 Herder continuous. Or more precisely, it's enough if it's piecewise Herder continuous. If you remember that I had pictures at the beginning, I don't want to go back to that. I had pictures of that type that the S matrix was represented by some block rectangle, block square, and there were certain numbers in the blocks. And that's a typical situation of a piecewise Herder continuous variance profile. It's just constant on these blocks, but then you have a big jump, and this is all allowed here. Now, under this condition, you will have the bound what I wanted here. So under this condition, I have a bound of order 1. And this is done, let me not go through it in full details. So this is done in such a way that you basically, you have an L2 bound, I mean, the idea is the following, you have an L, you already have an L2 bound. So now, if you want to do an L infinity bound, once you know an L2 bound, then the way to do it that you want to avoid the catastrophe is that something is bounded in L2 in such a way that some, not too many, but some coordinates are very big. That would be a situation when the L infinity bound is big, but the L2 bound is not big. So in order to avoid that, you basically want to prove that the components of this vector, they don't differ too much from each other. So in order to do that, you basically write up the equation for I and J for the two different indices, this equation here, and then you subtract it. You try to estimate the difference between the MI and the MJ. And then you do a little calculation, you apply from the equation. The 1 over m can be expressed in terms of the equation. You subtract it from the I and the j, and then you get something where the s, where the difference of two of s of the s matrix at two different points, ik and jk, explicitly appear, and then you can start using the Herder condition. So let me not go through it fully. It's written up in the notes. It's a little calculation, and the Herder 1/2 continuity is optimized for that. Okay, so in that way we got an L infinity bound as well, of course under this additional condition. Now let me come to the next thing, which is where you will see the real use of this F operator. Let me come to the stability of this equation. So far, what we achieved in this what I discussed now. So far, we achieved a bound, various useful bounds on the solution. And now you want to study the stability, and the stability is needed for many different things. Of course, it's needed. As I explained, it's needed for the local law when you compare the equation for the G, the resolvent elements and the solution. But it's actually also needed to establish these pictures. I mean, these pictures are established in such a way, the various Herder continuity and so on, these are established in such a way that you study this equation as you move the Z, as you move the spectral parameter a little bit. And this kind of analysis is also a stability analysis. You can view this, I write up the same equation for Z prime, where Z prime is close to Z, then you can view the new equation as a small perturbation of that equation. So this is, stability is fundamental. Okay. And of course, the key point is that everything has to be uniform in eta as eta goes to zero. All these things what I'm discussing here is are all trivial if you can have four bounds of 1/8 powers, but we cannot because we want to do a local low and we want to go eta go to zero. Okay. So here's this explicit theorem about the regularity, which I mentioned already before. So the statement is that, more precise statement, that we, so far from the general theory, we have seen that the solution is a Stieltjes transform from somebody. But now if you have, but now actually you can get much more. You can prove that this measure here, the generating measure is not just a measure, but it's absolutely continuous to the Lebesgue measure, and actually it's even has Herder one-third continuous. And also we know much more. We know that the support of all these measures are independent of mu I. I is the component, and also it has finitely many intervals. So it really looks like that as I'm drawing. It's not completely crazy thing. And we also know this real analytics. So these curves here, what you see, for example, the semicircle and all the other curves, these are all real analytic curves, of course, away from the singularity when it goes down to zero. Okay. And let me just show how one proves it using the stability operator. This introduces the stability operator of this equation. The easiest way is that this is the equation, and I want to see how it changes with z. So I differentiate the equation for z. That's easy. I get this guy. And now I try to solve this equation for the derivative of m. And that's also easy. It's a linear. Everything is linear here. So the derivative of m with respect to z is the same as m squared, but then there's this operator 1 minus m squared s acting upon that. So in other words, you can compute the derivative of m. If you want to prove regularity, you should control the derivative. You can compute the derivative. You will be able to estimate the derivative if you know the m squared, and if you can invert this operator of this matrix, this 1 minus m squared s matrix. And this is the key stability operator. And later on we will show, probably not today, but later on we will show that this operator, the inverse of this operator is bounded, and the bound is expressed in terms of the 1 over imaginary part of z. Remember, one imaginary part of z is the density, or rather this harmonic extension of the density. Actually it comes out with square. But that one shows that the stability operator, that the equation is stable, as long as you are not at the edge. Once you are away from the edge, then this imaginary part of m is strictly separated away from zero. Once you start approaching to the edge, then this bound blows up, and then you have to do something else, but this I'm not going to discuss. But once you know that, let me just do everything in the bulk. Once you know that, because m is analytic, and with using this bound, and using this equation and the bound on the inverse operator, you can easily get basically a differential inequality for the derivative of the imaginary part of m in terms of 1 over the imaginary part of m squared. So it leads to a simply OD of the type f prime is bounded by 1 over f squared. And then you know that it has Herder 1/3 continuous solutions. Okay, let me jump over this. Because I want to get well. So this is what I wrote here is actually I have to do that. So let me just recall what the spectral gap is. The spectral gap of a Hermitian matrix is a distance away from distance of the spectrum away from the largest eigenvalue. So let's draw a picture here. So if these are the eigenvalues here of a Hermitian matrix T, and this is the largest eigenvalue, somewhere there is a zero, then you look at the gap, and the gap is the distance between the largest eigenvalue and the next largest eigenvalue, but the largest eigenvalue is understood in terms of absolute value. So there's a more precise definition, but let me jump through it. And then, what? Oh, sorry, yeah, okay, yeah, very good. So then one can prove that this F operator has a spectral gap. I will discuss it the next time more carefully, and then let me just flash up this picture, and then we will continue from there next time. So the key point is that the stability operator is 1 minus m squared s, which we have to estimate from below. This you can rewrite in terms of the f operator. F is our good operator, which is now a symmetric operator, but twisted, rotated. So the 1 minus m squared s turns out to be 1 minus some, times a phase factor times f. And then the bound on this operator here follows from this picture. The f as a symmetric operator has a spectrum of this type. It has a largest eigenvalue coming from the Perron-Frobenius, And then there's a gap between the largest eigenvalue and the f, spectrum of the f. But then you would like to understand 1 minus f times a rotation. And then this rotation rotates, if you wish, in this naive picture, rotates the spectrum of f out of the real line. And then the distance between 1 and the spectrum of the f becomes large because of this rotation determined by this rotation angle. And this rotation angle is directly related to the imaginary part of m. So this is how we get the result, but I will review it next time. Okay.